Hey, Sashan, what's going on? Been a while since I've done one of these. We're going to talk about fast travel.
The journey, going there and back again, is part of the experience in roleplay games. And with the scope of some games getting bigger and bigger and the big open worlds becoming more expansive, then how the travel system is approached starts to be more important. In some games, there's a limiting factor, be it a resource, whether or not it's game currency or some other system, or in some cases like Warcraft's Hearthstone. It would give you a fast travel option once per hour. So you kind of thought more about when you would use it because of the cooldown. And of course, there were some ways around it. You could drop group in an instance and teleport away. If you know, people found ways to cheese it a little, but for the most part, it was trying to make it available, but not the first thing you think of. And, you know, you could play a mage, or you could, you know, get summoned by a warlock. There was lots of ways around it. I think the initial idea of a Hearthstone kind of put a limit to it where, you know, if you really just needed to get back, you could, but you couldn't, you know, just.
I think in Morrowind and modded Skyrim, maybe in Oblivion also, there was a trick where you had some sort of an amulet or a scroll of some sort, and you would use it, and it would take you, you would fast travel out of danger to a safe space, safe zone. Usually a temple somewhere where you could heal yourself. And it was like a one and done kind of thing. Like it would disappear as soon as you used it. Or maybe it wouldn't work again for a while. It'd have to recharge. Or you give it to the guy at the temple when you're done using it. Here, this saved my life. Thank you. And then you hand it to the guy. Because you don't get to keep it, you know. You could pay money for another one to use it another, you know, anyway. Yeah, Morrowind, the fast travel in Morrowind was pretty much a stilt rider. You'd pay them money to take you somewhere. Otherwise, you had to just run. If you had the magic boots, the magic boots of blinding speed, you know, you put those things on, you could cross Vardenfell or whatever pretty quick. You're blind, though. You don't see where you're going. You don't see what you're running into, what's trying to murder you, but you're pretty fast.
Constantly without thinking about it, where in the modern version of the game, travel is is very... there's lots of travel options. There's lots of just teleporting around, like whizzing around the whole map. And it makes the enormous game world feel tiny. In other games, like in Skyrim, The Witcher 3, Red Dead Redemption 2, games like that, there are multiple different levels of layers of conveyances. There's, the boats or carriages or the train.
Oh, that's right. Yeah, Morrowind and Oblivion, I think you would pay a mage and they would teleport you somewhere. If I remember right. The mages in Skyrim are just regular people with robes on. They don't really do much. There might be a teleport in Skyrim, but I don't do the mage thing all that much, so I don't know what's hidden deep in the bowels of the Mage's College. But yeah, you have boat travel, carriage travel. You can get a horse and just run faster. I mean, Skyrim is only 6 miles across. You don't really need to fast travel. You can just run everywhere in Skyrim. Just pick a direction, start running, Well, you'll be there in 10 minutes. If it's really far away. Because your character runs, for the most part, your character's running at almost 50 miles an hour. I mean, you're going to get there. You're going to get there. Let's see what she says about encounters. Because that's my pet peeve about fast travel, is you miss out on the encounters.
In Morrowind, there was like the Siltstriders or the boats. So sometimes there's like in MMOs, there's usually...
Oh, yeah, that's right. There was a boat in Morrowind to take you to Solstheim. And, or to take you to another boat or Vivek. You know, you could go to Vivek. You could go to the place on the west coast. I can't remember the name of it. It was a marsh area. Yeah, I forgot about the boat guys.
Usually like flight paths, but then there's also different ways to teleport between like the capitals or, you know. Also in Morrowind, there was the Mage's Guild where you could pay gold to transport between the different mages colleges. Depending on your actions in the game, you could ruin the chance to do that or reduce the cost of it. And
yeah, I think you had to be friends with the mages, otherwise they wouldn't give you the time of day. I think in the vanilla game. Maybe in the modded game, there's probably even more options with the mages.
That was kind of a nice layer of RPG that, where it was like there was sort of a motivation for you to behave in one way.
Yeah, I remember some of the mages in Morrowind, you'd ask them to take you somewhere. Some of them had an attitude. All the time. Some of them were super nice about it. Depending on what race you were. Because mages are racist too.
One way or another, you know, there was consequences, be it minor, to your actions. Or there was a benefit for helping them out. That's kind of nice to have different ways to include it in Warcraft. When you had higher rep with the faction... It owned the flight path. It gave you a reduced cost at every different faction level. That stopped mattering when the game economy changed to the point that the flight paths were a negligible amount of money, but it made more of a difference originally with the economy. But, in games like New World, where you have your Azoth energy, then basically, if you don't craft, you can just teleport constantly because you earn enough of it. And it's a very strange choice they made that, that crafters need Azoth to craft, but everybody uses it to teleport, it's a peculiar choice. In games with a lot of shrines or fast travel points, then it gets to the point where you're playing the UI and you're no longer interacting with the game world anymore. And
is she going to mention Starfield? Maybe she already did, but Starfield has the worst fast travel.
I think a big thing that makes me, at least, decide on the side of convenience of, taking myself out of the world is when I just don't feel like the trip there is going to be eventful or interesting. And in some games, there's nothing to see, there's no treasure to find. There's no random.
That's right. Skyrim out of the box is boring as fuck. You have to mod Skyrim because it's just beta at best out of the box. There is nothing to see. When you leave a town, there is absolutely nothing to see between towns if you just go on a walk. That's why you mod the game. Then you don't use fast travel as much because the world is actually interesting now.
Random encounters to be had. Like, there's no interesting, hidden, even like visual things just slightly off the beaten path. A weird way I've seen it handled in some games, like Black Desert Online or like The Witcher. I think they might even have this in Red Dead. I can't remember.
I'll have to look and see how big Witcher and Red Dead maps are. Like, how big is their worlds compared to Skyrim?
But they have like a way that you can kind of auto-navigate in your character. So you can have them walk through the world for you.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah, Skytrek does that in Skyrim. You get on your horse and the horse takes you somewhere. And it takes the scenic route.
And I used to like that in Lord of the Rings Online. I liked to get on the horse path and let my character ride through, and I would just look around at the scenery. But
And also for Skyrim, there's the touring carriages. You get on the carriage ride. You don't fast travel. It's slow travel in a carriage. So it's a sight. It's a tour carriage. You go on a tour. It's buggy as hell. It can break your game sometimes, but if it works, it works. It's swell.
I'm not sure that that's a good solution because, I don't see a big reason in making the journey if you're going to do it like AFK. I mean, sometimes you do need to just step away from the game, but that in that circumstance, it feels like teleporting to a safe area and then just leaving your character idle makes more sense. Like, in Elder Scrolls Online, every time I needed to step away, I would just teleport to the nearest like safe area because it was like negligible to do so. Games with like absolutely broken economy.
Yeah, Ultima Online, you just run like heck to this nearest town. The guards will protect you, and then you can be away from the keyboard and not worry about your character dead when you come back from lunch.
Economy systems, the amount of currency it takes for like taxis and teleports just stops mattering really quickly in the game. But
in my current game, I'm not picking up gold everywhere I see it. I'm just leaving the gold where it is. The only gold I have is gold that I earn from doing jobs. Otherwise, if I pick up all the gold I see everywhere, I'm the richest person in Skyrim. Like, no one else steals. I'm the only thief in Skyrim. No one steals in Skyrim. There's money laying around. No one takes it. Coin purses everywhere. No one takes them. I'm the only one who's going to be stealing in the game. So I thought, you know what? Don't pick up gold. Don't take gold laying around. Don't take gold from the monsters. You know, don't. Why is there gold in monsters anyway?
I find that like I preferred.
I mean, I know why there's gold in monsters, but why is there gold in monsters? It's like, people have gold teeth. They get eaten by a bear. Now the bear has gold teeth inside the bear.
The games where you needed to kind of familiarize yourself with the world. Like, there are some games that I spent so much time figuring out where everything was in relation to something else because I actually traveled down on the ground or like on a mount. But, you know, I went through the areas so thoroughly that I knew them as if they were real places. And there's a lot of games that, like, I couldn't even tell you what zone it is just looking at a picture of it. Like, so I feel like there's been, like, kind of a push away from the slower, more more roleplay adventure sort of exploration. And I wonder if that's because like the scope of the areas has gotten out of hand and it would just be too time consuming to make every little square inch of them interesting. Like,
I haven't played a multiplayer game in almost 30 years. So I have no idea. I mean, I have an idea. I've watched people play WoW and other games online. But I prefer solo, you know, not solo. What is it called? Single player games with either AI scenarios, skirmishes, or campaign stuff, missions to do. Again, against the AI. You want to mod the AI as best as possible. But multiplayer stuff, I don't do it. It's just, are people role playing? If you can find a multiplayer platform where there's actual role players, that would be great. That would be amazing. But now that, you know, multiplayer games are worldwide, yeah, used to be you just had crazy people in the US. No, there's crazy people all over the internet. And they're trying to kill you. They're trying to stab you in the backside.
Or I wonder if there's something else to it. I mean, like, in some games, the maps are procedurally generated, and that's totally fine because, you know, you have to start somewhere, and you don't necessarily need to handcraft every little hill or valley, but, you know, a lot of them, they go back over and refine them and add, you know, some level of interest, some reason to travel them. And I feel like that's been lacking in a lot of games. I don't really want to wait.
I guess I like handcrafted maps. See, Skyrim's pretty small. It's about it's about 8 times bigger than Disneyland. Is that right? Or is it 16 times bigger than Disneyland? Yeah, probably 16 times bigger than Disneyland. So it's handcrafted, theme park rides everywhere. Once in a while, it's copy-paste. You know, they'll design a trail, a road going through some mountains. And it'll be in a snow area. And they'll just copy-paste that to another area on the map and change the snow textures to grass textures. But it's the same exact path, the same turn, the same incline. Hopefully not the same encounters. That would suck. But for the most part, Skyrim is handcrafted. An army of 3 SJW employees handcrafting Skyrim landscape, landmarks, you know, that sort of thing. Because a fractal generator or procedural generated thing, it's not going to include that stuff. It's just going to be, for the most part, flat land with scattered rocks and boulders. No road of any kind.
Waste my actual time traveling back and forth. I think a good way that this could be handled, and this is usually restricted to just the starting zones, like the tutorial areas of MMOs or some single-player role-play games, is that they have restricted at first travel. Like in SWTOR, when you are doing your starting planet, you need to do all the quests. All the main story quests. Not, you can skip some of the side quests, but once you do, then you unlock the option to leave the starting planet and travel to other planets. In some other areas, like Lord of the Rings, you needed to finish the starting area before you could go out into the bigger world. But I think one second.
Well, in Skyrim, another world would just be the next town. So like Helgen is a town. And that's the tutorial. Once you get through that, then you can go visit other towns. And if you level up enough, other towns are open for traveling to. You just have to be leveled up a bit more.
I think all games at any level could benefit from having a more localized quest hop where there was more of a limit on how many times you were asked to run across, like completely across the map. You know, like if games themselves put more weight on travel, maybe that would make it less incentivized to instantly travel. Like if you are able to pick up a lot of quests that can be done quickly on foot to the point you don't even want to mount up or travel away, and you can like easily return to turn them in, then you're less likely to want to teleport around. Whereas, you know, if there's a quest like, hey, go completely to the other side of the map to just talk to this guy and then come back, then, you know, you're not going to spend 40 minutes physically walking there and to return just for a quick message. You're going to just teleport, not never give it a second thought, come back and progress the quest. So I think, you know, like...
Sometimes I'm not in the mood to walk all the way clear across Skyrim because I killed a lot of junk on the way on the first... You know, the first way. And then it's like if I go back, I have to take another route. Because everything's dead. Ahead of me, everything's dead already. If I just reverse the way I came. But if I go a different route, I'll see, you know, different encounters, that kind of thing. And it's like, okay, it's dark. It's going to be uneventful. It's, you know, filming in the dark in a YouTube stream kills viewers. Viewers want to see broad daylight scenery. So it's like, okay, it's nighttime. I'll just fast travel. No one wants to watch me run across Skyrim for 10 minutes in the dark, getting attacked by just random crazy stuff. And I just need to return something. I don't die cold and miserable in the dark. It depends on my mood. If I'm in the mood to do that, I'll do it. Maybe I can find the guy. Need a boat? You know, that guy. I can take you anywhere. That'll save time.
There's kind of the joke, well, why didn't the Eagles just fly, you know, fly the Fellowship directly to Mount Doom, right? But I mean, that's kind of the point. Like, the whole story is of the journey from a starting point to an end point. And I think more games could benefit from having a gradual progression through the game to the point where you don't want to teleport back and forth. You know, it's like you have sort of a feeling of completion when you finish a zone and move on to the next one. Maybe even save the breadcrumb, hey, there's more world out there quest until later in the progression of that story area. Like, you know, it's like, oh, you've done most of what you could do here. Why don't you go to the next little hub and then quest there? It feels, I don't know, it feels like it would incentivize playing all the way through an area more than just having all kinds of quests that send you everywhere. So something that I really enjoyed doing, and it kind of led me into playing more of the survival type games, is there was a camping mod for Skyrim. And there's also a...
Yes, Frostfall and Campfire. I tried both of them. There's Hunter Born or something like that. You just go around hunting, dressing animals, that kind of thing. But that's what you, your game turns into that, though. You're not doing Skyrim anymore. You're playing some other kind of game.
A lot of inns just in the game naturally, in the different holes of the game. There's an inn and there's some remotely.
Like, you can't fast travel unless you have a backpack, an axe, a torch, some health potions. The game won't let you fast travel unless you have those things. I think you have to even have firewood. You have to chop firewood to make a campfire. You have to have a tent roll, a bed roll, you know, all that kind of stuff. Otherwise, you just freeze to death and die somewhere up on a mountain that you could not climb down. That reminds me, I need to put hyperthermia in my game so I can start freezing to death.
So I just decided that my character was going to slowly go through and do area by area, and I would have her camp out every time it would be night. And, you know, I used a hunting mod, so she would hunt for food and cook it at night and gather snow and melt it for water and that sort of thing. And it added like a whole different layer of enjoyment for me, that traveling actually felt like a journey, and it wasn't necessary at all, but it was enjoyable.
I like the blizzards. Wet and cold had blizzards. So you're out in the snow, a thick blizzard. You can't see more than 20 feet in front of you. And neither can the enemies, the bandits, they're trying to murder you. They can't see you either. So that was cool. Fighting in a blizzard at night gets pretty intense. And there's snow covering our bodies because we're just, it's just, it's what they call it. It's not heartwarming at all.
And a lot of the games that have the survival elements included out of the box just turn them into more of an annoyance than a benefit.
Yeah, you got to be careful if you turn on hard mode with the Skyrim Anniversary Edition. It'll ask you, do you want to be in hard mode? It's like, what? And then if you don't know what you're doing, you hate the game. You hate playing Skyrim first time out of the box because you pick survival mode.
Because they're just, you know.
I think Fallout New Vegas has a survival mode too, I think.
There's something nagging at you while you're trying to do something else. It's not just a layer of enrichment that is available should you want it, but isn't going to bother you. So I don't know. The survival aspect didn't really feel...
But Chesco was insisting on getting paid for modding. He was one of those guys. Back in 2015, there was a global panic. Nexus Mods was thinking, hey, we should start charging for mods. No, people were panicked. We're in panic mode. The customers complained. It happened for maybe a week, and then it was turned off. And people were campaigning that their mods would be free forever. And they would put these logos on their mod screens saying, forever free, you know, that kind of thing. It's still a thing. If you go to Nexus Mods, you often see the logo. Free forever. The modder does not want to make money on the mod. Now, you can buy them a coffee. You can do that. You can do PayPal. Send them some money if you like their mod. That's about it.
Like, like the same thing as travel, but I feel like they're closely related. So I kind of am just saying it at the end. But yeah, I feel like their survival systems were kind of a way of addressing like travel in open worlds and making them feel a bit more.
Here's the thing. Skyrim, the Skyrim designed for play did not come up with, the developers did not think of survival mode when they were making the game. So out of the box, the game, it doesn't take survival mode into account in its game design. But when you slap on, oh, I want to be in survival mode, you're basically breaking how the game works. All the things that you're told you can do in the game, you now might not be able to do. Because you've changed the game. You're playing a different game than Skyrim.
More, I don't want to just use the word immersive, but, you know, you have more of a...
Some of the survival modes, you have to have a horse with food. Horse food. Horse chow. You have to have that if you're going to even fast travel. If you're not on a horse, you have to walk.
Feeling that your character is on a journey through a land or a story than just, you know, I don't really like when games where I'm playing the UI. I like where I'm actually interacting with the world. So I don't like too many menus or too much, you know, like having a map is...
The widgets, too many widgets telling you you're almost dead. Instead of the widget telling you you're perfectly healthy, drink a potion, you're healthy. No, the widgets tell you stuff like you are going to die.
It's good for reference, but using a map to just teleport directly there really pulls me out of the game personally. How do you feel about it? Is there a game that you feel like has a good balance between the convenience of fast travel? Do you value your time to the point that you don't want to waste it going somewhere you've already been before? Or do you enjoy like a slow-paced journey? I'm curious. Take care.
That was a good video. I'm uploading now.